We were just noticing that mom was not her vibrant self. She wasn't taking her medications. She got confused how to fill up her pill boxes. Every day is a little piece of me and mom that gets lost.
For every major chronic disease like Alzheimer's, we're faced with a race against time.
I'm fairly certain I'm going to get this disease.
I feel still a little bit scared.
What year is this?
Jean Renton and her family, as well as countless other patients that we look after with the Hopkins model of care for dementia, benefit from the sort of brain trust that we have available. I'm especially proud at Hopkins how we've stepped up to the plate to deal with Alzheimer's as the sort of disease that requires people from different specialties, physicians, basic scientists, nurses, etc., working together to bring the advances of tomorrow.
Well, in the late 1880s, if you were a medical student, there were no admissions requirements except that you had to pay a fee to the professor, doctor, owner of the proprietary school. Once you took all the courses and you'd finished paying your fees, you graduated and you were a doctor.
Medical education and medical practice really weren't regulated at that time.
You can imagine that that didn't bode well for most patients.
What a remarkable vision and what a remarkable gift. $7 million in those days was a huge sum of money.
Johns Hopkins had a really unique vision, a vision in which the medical school and hospital would work together to help train doctors, and was really a pioneer in ensuring that this type of medical training would occur in the country.
That $7 million gift really changed everything. It set up a new model for how to bring together teaching, clinical care, and research, and really establish a paradigm for the country going forward.
This was a pivotal time. The vision in which a physician would not only train at the bedside, but in the laboratory was very unique. Thus, Hopkins led the way in having physicians go from the bench to the bedside and help train clinician scientists.
Physicians on the faculty were making discoveries in the morning and teaching about them to their students in the afternoon. And their students would rotate from the laboratory to the bedside and back and forth. They would spend some time in classroom, but the important activity was either in the laboratory or at the bedside with the patients.
Flexner's report recommended that the Hopkins model, if you will, become the model for American medical education, and in fact led to a change in the way we're doing things.
What binds this family, this Hopkins family together, is really the patient-oriented research, a shared goal of trying to do something new and important for patients.
The patient is the first teacher for every physician. What we learn from all of them, really, goes back into our bench. In our bench, we start understanding how are we going to make it better for them, and we bring different ideas back to the bedside. And in the long term, that's how advances are going to really happen.
So research isn't done by one person sitting in a lab or sitting in an office thinking of things. It's done by people really talking to each other and coming up with different ideas. And it's very, very collaborative. And the best new ideas really come from the interface when people talk to each other coming from different perspectives. And that's something that we have a lot of at Hopkins.
In addition to having some of the premier scientists in the world here, we are extraordinarily enriched for people who want to make an impact in their field. We work hard, we collaborate vigorously, and we make great discoveries.
The other reason to be at Johns Hopkins is that you have this incredible opportunity to train the next leaders of your specialty. The ability to take what you do and show your residents how to do an operation or a procedure is a thrill. It's a thrill.
Johns Hopkins was a man who was committed to the care of underserved patients and people who belong to disadvantaged backgrounds. So I think it is very interesting that 100 years later, that here I am trying to sort of forge a new path and a renewed interest in understanding the reasons for those differences in health and those differences in access to care and quality of care and developing solutions.
Feels natural to me because it's sort of this extension of the vision of Mr. Hopkins and the early trustees that we should not only promote new discovery but then share that with humankind.
From an impact perspective, the fact that we can be out in the world, work side by side with local healthcare providers, local governments to improve their healthcare delivery, that is orders of magnitude greater impact to be able to work in those communities because not everybody can come here and experience it firsthand.
A building is not some sort of abstract kind of notion. A building is there to serve people, in my view. And the particular group of people, of course, are the patients and their families. And the environment that I believe needs to be created around them is one in which you can point to elements of the environment that promote healing.
Networks of hospitals and community health centers working together to solve important problems will essentially be the future Johns Hopkins Medicine.
We're experiencing an important shift, I think, from managing illness to managing health. We become good at seeing issues and patterns in groups of patients, patient populations, and the result is improved strategies for prevention and for intervention. If I had a wish for the future, it would be that we're called Johns Hopkins Health, and that we worry about the health of the communities we serve. It's about taking care of those people.
If you catch it early, there's so many things that you can do to preserve the memories that you have, to, you know, get in touch with people for making plans and kind of easing the road.
The challenge we face every day is balancing a race for the cure with providing the best care that we can right now for the people and their families who face it right now and who aren't going to benefit from the cure when it comes.
I think that there is definitely hope down there. Not for my age group necessarily, but certainly for my children and my grandchildren. And so, you know, I don't want them to have to go through this if that's at all possible.
People come here for a variety of reasons, but they stay here primarily to be a part of something special, to contribute to our history of leading in American medicine and extend that into the future, where we're still trying to make a difference in everything that we do. There's a coming home here, and it's a great home to be a part of.
You come to Hopkins because you can accomplish something here that matters in your life. There's a mission, a purpose, a living for the intellectual challenge of it and the emotional reward of doing well.
We all know we're working towards something that's bigger than ourselves. We see it in the patients. We see it each time we publish a paper with new knowledge. And we look towards the future. And that, I think, is really what drives us all.